get down, let's get down to business. Give you one more night to get this. We've had a million, million nights just like this. So let's get down to business.
Good afternoon, Ava here. I would like to welcome everyone to the iBUG Apple Workshop, episode number 144, for Saturday, October 28, 2023. Thank you to those joining us this afternoon, and to those of you listening to the recorded playback. More and more of the blind community are finding the Apple devices to be useful assistive technology tools in their daily lives. Whether at home, at work or school, or on the go, the accessibility features of the Apple devices have cleared new pathways for the blind to be more productive, consume online content, and stay connected through social media. We have an exciting meeting planned for today. We will first review some iBUG announcements and some recent Apple news and rumors. Then, Herbie and Terry Ann will demo a couple of iPhone apps. Finally, we will spend any remaining time to answer general questions you may have. I would now like to turn the meeting over to the iBUG guy, Michael McCulloch. Ready to go, Michael?
Yes, yes, yes. We are ready to go. What a fantastic afternoon for our 144 episode of iBUG Apple Workshop. And I also want to give my personal welcome to everyone this afternoon here in person and also those listening on the recorded playback. Glad you could join us. We've got an exciting meeting this afternoon. But before we get started, we need to do some things like, well, most of you already know all this. We'd like everybody to stay on mute unless you have a question. Then we don't use the raise hand feature, so be sure just to say your name, wait to be acknowledged, and then we'll pass the mic over to you. All right. That's really the only kind of housekeeping need to deal with. We want to probably go around the room and just have everybody introduce themselves. So we're going to ask you to come off the mic, say your name, where you're calling from, and a little icebreaker question that we always like to start out with. We know Halloween's coming up in a few days, so a lot of people like their have favorite treats that they like to get. But I want to know, what is your least favorite Halloween treat as you introduce yourself? So let's get it going. Who would like to go first? Sandhya.
This is Herbie in Houston. And I would say that one of my least favorite Halloween candies was always like those sour candies.
Sour candies. All right. Welcome, Herbie.
Very, very good. And my favorite Tootsie Roll.
Tootsie Rolls. All right. Sticks in your teeth. Okay. Who else we got
this
out there?
Terry from Arlington Heights. Candy bars with caramel and nuts and that kind of stuff. They're way too sweet for me.
Canada and Colorado, Tootsie Roll, they stick to your teeth. I never did like them, so.
All right, Janet.
Yep, you're right. You can't set me straight.
All right, Herbie, we can hear you in the background there. All right, who's next? Come on.
Max Greenberg, Arlington, Virginia. Candy corn.
Candy corn, oh my goodness.
Too sweet.
Tell me your first name again.
Nancy.
Nancy, okay, from Arlington, yeah. Virginia. Okay, great. Glad to have you, Nancy. Who else we got out there?
Helene. Yeah. Sure, go ahead.
Okay, Helene's first, then Julia.
Jawbreakers.
Jawbreakers, and where are you calling from, Helene?
I'm calling from Woodstock.
Woodstock, New York. New York, yes, yes, yes. All right, Julia, what's up with you?
Coffee crisp.
And tell me, Julia, remind me where you're from.
Ontario, Canada.
All right, way up there. Welcome. Who else we got out there?
Carol Vincent from Houston,
New Jersey.
I'm sorry.
All right, Carol, then Vincent.
Yeah, my least favorite candy, I guess it's the candy corn as well.
All right, and Carol's right here in Houston. Let's say, go ahead.
I don't have any favorite candy. I don't eat candy.
Least favorite treat.
Least favorite. Least favorite. Definitely candy corn.
Candy corn. Okay. Yeah, for those joining in a little bit late, we are going around introducing ourselves. Name, where you're from, and your least favorite Halloween treat. Who's next?
Gloria from Houston.
Okay, Brian, and then I didn't hear Julia. No.
Gloria.
Or Gloria. Okay. Go ahead.
Yeah, Brian from Ontario, and I agree with Herbie. I hate sour treats.
Okay, no sour for you.
I am sour enough already.
I was getting ready to say the same thing, you old fart. All right, who's next?
Gloria from Houston.
Yes,
candy corn and sour candy.
All right. Okay. Welcome, Gloria. Who else we got out there?
Paul in Columbus.
From Newfoundland, Canada.
All right. Let's see. I heard Paul and then Elizabeth.
Paul in Columbus, Ohio. Licorice and sour stuff.
Okay. Elizabeth, go ahead.
Eat more bar.
Wait, I didn't catch that. What?
Eat more bar. Eat more.
Okay. I'm not familiar with that, but I will trust that that's your least favorite.
Right.
All right. Very good. Welcome, Elizabeth from Newfoundland. All right. Who's next out there?
This is Dan from Southern California.
Hey, Dan.
Yeah, I think my least favorite is licorice. It's too messy for me.
Oh, yeah. Leaves a bad taste. Okay, who else we got?
This is Shree.
Shree.
Black licorice.
Black licorice. Okay, that would not be very good. Yes. Okay, who else?
Jody in New Hampshire.
All right, Jody.
Yeah, my least favorite is anything with coconut in it.
Anything with coconut. Okay.
Although I agree with Herbie about the sour. That's another one too.
All right.
Richard in Houston.
Yeah. Go ahead, Richard.
Milk duds.
Those stick in your teeth as much as the Tootsie Rolls. Okay. Welcome, Richard. Okay. Who else we got out there? I know there's a couple more.
Elisa and Porter. What was the iceberg question?
What's your least favorite Halloween treat or tweet?
The Tootsie Rolls.
Okay. Very good. Who else we got? Anybody else that didn't get a chance to introduce yourselves? Just come off mute, say your name. Okay, back to the...
This is Sandhya.
Sandhya.
I think there's something wrong with me because I like all the things that people hated. But anyway, I don't like Tootsie Rolls, so there you go.
No Tootsie Rolls for you. Okay. And again, this is Michael in Texas. And my least favorite is Pepto-Bismol. Leaves your tongue black.
Oh, come on.
This is Jake from Michigan.
Hey, Jake.
Yes, my favorite thing for Halloween is Snickers bars.
What's your least favorite?
Candy corn. I don't like candy corn.
All right, no candy corn for you either. Okay, anybody else before we move on?
This is David All from right. Arkansas.
Oh, David.
Yeah, sour candies.
Any sour candies. Okay, sour candies and the sticky candies are running neck and neck here today.
Okay, this is Sarah from Vermont.
Sarah.
Hey, what was the question?
what, What is your least favorite Halloween treat?
Oh, I'm going to go with what a few people back said. Candy corn. Hate
candy
it.
Corn. All right. I like the chocolate ones, though. All right. Wow. Anybody else?
It's Greg in Texas.
Greg.
And I would vote for candy corn and licorice.
All right. One of those that can't follow directions. We only wanted one, but that's okay, Greg. We'll let you have two. Okay, who else we got out there? All right, I think that takes care of everyone. If we didn't catch you, we'll catch you around on the next hour. All right, so kindly everyone go on mute and, well, we'll see. I didn't catch you for sure. Was there any first timers here to this meeting? Forgot to ask you to say that. Anybody that's your first time here? Okay, well, welcome back, everyone, to our iBUG Apple Workshop. And let's see, we want to celebrate anyone that had a birthday in October. Any October birthdays out there? There's got to be several. That's a popular one.
Me.
Julie's coming up on Halloween. Yes, yes, yes. Anybody else? Come on. I know there's at least one or two more out there.
This is Shree.
Shree.
Our daughter had her birthday on the 18th.
The 18th. Okay, very good. And remind me, what's your daughter's name?
Jasmine.
Yes, very good. So happy belated birthday to Miss Jasmine. All right, anybody else? October birthdays.
This is Vincent.
All right, Vincent.
I have a daughter that was born on October 23rd and a son that was born October 27th.
Wow. Okay. You were busy back in January. All right. Who
end
else?
Of January.
All right. All right. All right. Anybody else going once, going twice, October birthdays? All right. Well, I have to admit, I also had an October birthday on the 16th. Which is also the same as my grandmother, who passed away a number of years ago. She was exactly 60 years older than me. So that's been a while. Okay, very good. Thanks, everybody, for sharing that. And we're going to move right along here. We've got a few announcements regarding iBUG. Next week, normally next Saturday would be our iBUG Unplugged, but a number of the iBUG team is going to be at the NFB Texas Convention, which happens to be here in Houston. And so we're going to have to cancel that meeting in November, but we will be back in the first Saturday in December. So please join us for that. And we've got a book club, our Vila book club, if you're not aware of that. That's on the second Thursday of each month. So November 9th, we're currently reading the book, The Devil in the White City, by some guy named Eric Larson. If you want to try to find the book on Bard NLS, it's DB 55748. You still got plenty of time to read that book and join us November 9th, 6:30 Central Time. The next Sunday, or the following Sunday, November 12th, we've got the iBUG Cafe at 4 p.m. Central. And Shree Roy, who facilitates that, at the meeting, I'm going to ask him just to tell you quickly what's coming up for that meeting. Go ahead.
Yeah, we're going to be covering the Envision app and the glasses and the OrCam.
All right. So come find out more about those new glasses. Well, they're not totally new, but new things with those glasses. Okay, then Wednesday, November 15th, we have our Android meeting, the iBUG Android Insight. That's at 7 o'clock p.m. Central. And then because Thanksgiving weekend, the fourth Saturday, we won't be here. So we're going to move up the Apple workshop 1 week earlier. That'll be on November 18th. So come back and join us 2 p.m. Same time, same channel here. And then rounding out the month will be, well, actually a couple more things. The fourth Tuesday, November 28th. We have iBUG Mac and Talk at 7 p.m. Central, also right here on this same Zoom. And because the fourth Thursday happened to be on Thanksgiving, we're going to move It's iBUG's Life to the fifth Thursday. We're lucky to have five Thursdays. So that's going to be November 30th. So it'll be a combined November-December meeting, actually. And they're going to be talking about holiday baking, cooking, and other good things. Of course, every Monday night, always can join us at 7 p.m. Central for iBUG Buzz. That's where we talk about any issues, questions you have on iOS products. Then we have Clubhouse every Tuesday afternoon. The first and third Tuesdays at 5 p.m., we have Mac Buzz. We talk a little bit about iOS, or not iOS, Mac OS and Mac hardware questions, issues. And then the mini buzz happens on the second and fourth Tuesdays on Clubhouse at 5 p.m. You're always welcome to join us there. It's just a shortened version of our Monday night buzz. Also, the first and third Thursdays of each month, we have iBUG's Trekkie Talk, and Jody's here with us. She's the facilitator for that, and that's at 8 p.m. Central. We're currently in the middle of the Next Generation series, season 7, and I forget which episodes are coming up on the first Thursday coming up next week, actually.
Episodes, this is Sandhya.
Sandhya.
Episodes
8 and 9 in season 7. All right. And of course, every Friday night, we have our iBUG Night at the Virtual Movies. We just saw last night, if you weren't there, The Wizard of Oz. Lots of fun for that classic old, what is it, 84-year-old movie. And we had lots of fun watching that and lots of trivia about that movie. So we've got, of course, a new movie coming up this coming Friday. And if you want to know what it is, you can join us Monday night where we give out clues to what that movie is going to be. And whoever guesses it gets some great prizes. What else we got? Oh, our Jumpstart Mentoring Program. Anybody new to the iPhone, beginners, you can sign up for the Jumpstart Mentoring Program. And Sandhya, tell them a little bit more about that.
All right. That's where if you need help with your iPhone, we have wonderful advanced volunteer mentors that will help you through that journey, because it is a difficult journey at the beginning. And so you fill out the application on our website. And on the other side, if you would like to help somebody, we could definitely use your help as a mentor. If you're an advanced user, feel pretty confident with your phone, we'd love to have you. And there's a similar application for mentors. So please think about it, and we look forward to working with you.
All right. Yes. Just go to our website, look under the training link, and you'll see the Jumpstart Mentoring link to get signed up for those. The last iBUG announcement I have, if you don't get enough of iBUG Buzz on Monday nights or the Clubhouse Tuesdays, You can always listen to highlights of each of the Monday nights. That's on the Sight into Sound, their iBUG Buzz internet radio, where they take our Monday night 2-hour program, pick out the highlights and condense it down to a 30-minute program. And that's available on demand or also at certain times. I can't even remember the times now. Wednesdays at 1:30 and p.m. and 5:30 a.m. Central. So you can go online to the internet, go into sightintosound.org, and you will find that. Okay. Oh, I guess I need to tell you about our contact, how to get in touch with us and how to keep up with all the good things going on, all these things that I just mentioned. You can always go to our website, ibugtoday.org, and there you can find the upcoming events. Also on Facebook, we have a group, facebook.com/groups/ibugtoday, or our Facebook page is just facebook.com/ibugtoday, and you can follow us there. Also Twitter, our handle there is @ibugtoday. Same thing on Instagram. Or if you need to find out more about administrative kind of things, you can always send an email to ibugtoday@gmail.com. Okay, so that's a mouthful, and I am tired, so I am going to now hand it over to Sandhya to give you the latest on Apple news and rumors over this past month. Take it away, Sandhya.
So today we're going to start off by commemorating Steve Jobs. He is the person who had the vision and created the products that have brought us together here today. He had the vision and the creativity and made it Apple what it is today, and we are so grateful. He passed away on October 5th, 2011. And he was only 56 years old. He had been battling pancreatic cancer since he was 49. He actually received a liver transplant. And at the commencement ceremony at Stanford University in 2009, he thanked the family of the donor, who was only in their mid-20s, for his second chance. Jobs' final public appearance was on June 7, 2011. He was representing Apple at a Cupertino County meeting where he spoke about plans to build Apple Park. And just 3 months later, on August 24, 2011, Jobs formally stepped down as Apple CEO. On the last day, he reportedly chaired a board meeting, tried to fool pre-release version of SIRI with questions, and then that evening he told his biographer, Walter Isaacson, that, quote, "I have had a lucky career, a very lucky life. Next, DuckDuckGo could have been Apple's private search engine. This private search engine, DuckDuckGo, could have been the default for private browsing in Safari, but talks allegedly fell through under the might of Google's influence. The Department of Justice is now investigating Google for antitrust practices and abuse of power with bench trial set very soon. Apple and Google have an agreement in place that makes Google the default search engine on iPhone and other Apple products. It also stipulated that Apple can't create Google competitors or display alternative search engines at device setup. This deal between Google and Apple is at the heart of the Department of Justice antitrust investigation into Google. The trial is far from over and could have ramifications for both Google and Apple's business depending on the final ruling. Google is now updating its virtual assistant with artificial intelligence. The new program is called Bard. Yes, just like our own very own Bard. That's going to be confusing. And it's going to be able to do all kinds of cool things. One of them that I really liked is you'd be able to show it a picture and it will create a social media post just from its review of the picture. They say that it can plan your next trip, search for details buried in your inbox, make a grocery list for your next getaway, and all kinds of stuff in between. Apple is also working on the artificial intelligence component and hopefully will add that to SIRI in the future. The next story is something we have been talking about for a while, the use of AirTags for very dangerous purposes, specifically using the AirTag to stalk someone. So now there is a lawsuit in Northern California by 36 people complaining about the use of the AirTags and Apple's failure to really mitigate the danger of the AirTags. Some of the things that are alleged in the complaint is that many people have been assaulted, injured, even murdered while trying to either retrieve a lost bag or property, or ex-partners stalking their victims. And these are serious allegations, and Apple has not yet responded publicly. All right, guys, you know how much we love dongles, and now there's even more reason to check your cable stash, because there is something that is worth $200. This is an obscure adapter that has vintage Mac fans in an uproar because it's the only device that helps you to connect modern digital displays without a hardware swap. It's the adapter that you've never heard of and whose name does not exactly trip off the tongue. Here we go. It's called the Belkin F2E9142WHT ADC2DBI cable. So this cable breathes new life into vintage Mac products by allowing them to connect with modern displays. So if you happen to have one of those, I'm not going to repeat it again, you are in luck because they're going for over $200. So recent patent submissions suggest that Apple is working on an all-glass and covered iPhone with a wraparound display, and it might be round too. So what does this mean? So the future iPhone could be completely covered with seamless glass with zero penetration for wire ports and could even have a wraparound display. Apple's iPhone with all glass enclosure in the patent is simply titled Glass Enclosure. While images and discussions depict the old-fashioned click wheel iPod, the glass could be extruded in a tube, allowing for devices with round edges and a tubular body to be made. Like tubular. Couldn't resist that. Now, one of my favorite stories. A Swedish luxury firm called Golden Concepts is promoting its latest product, an iPhone 15 Pro Max and an Apple Watch Ultra 2 encrusted in diamonds. How many diamonds, you might say? How about 7,586 diamonds? That will go a long way. It could be yours for the cool price of $250,000. And, well, if anybody's listening, my birthday is coming up, and I would gladly accept such a beautiful gift. Remember, diamonds are a girl's best friend. Finally, for all of our iBUG Trekkie fans, this is the news you are waiting for. Apple is researching how to make a Star Trek communicator badge. Yes, yes. They are doing some research on making a wearable loudspeaker that would use beamformed audio to make it clearly audible to the wearer, yet not disturb anyone else. At heart, this is how to solve the problem of your entire away team plus enemy aliens hearing when your mother calls to ask if you remembered your coat. So, with this device, you too can say, beam me up, Scotty.
All right. Yes, yes, yes. Thank you, Sandhya. Wow, lots of great news from the Appleverse this past month. Let's see. Why don't we unmute and let people, if anybody has any comments or questions on anything that either I or Sandhya just made announcements on.
This is Shree.
Go ahead, Shree.
So, Sandhya, on that $250,000 phone, does it support MagSafe?
That wasn't the main thrust of it, Shree. Oh. It's all about the diamonds, okay? And then
are they natural diamonds or man-made diamonds?
I'm assuming they're real diamonds.
Gotta be real diamonds.
And they said they were going to throw in another product, but it's not an Apple product. It was kind of vague. So you get the iPhone, the Apple Watch, and then another product. And it's
I think I know what that is.
Yeah?
It's a sucker lollipop along with it.
Thanks, Shree.
All right. Any other questions? Quickly.
Jody,
go ahead.
Yeah, the heck with the diamonds. I want the communicator.
I thought you'd like that one.
Yeah. I'm waiting on Jody to come in on that one.
Hi, this is Paul.
Yeah, Paul, go ahead.
Yeah, just curious if you had more information about that dongle for the video for a different Mac or whatever. I've got a 2015 27-inch iMac, which has a great screen on it for what like little bit I can see of it. But it's such a good monitor, and it's the rest of the system is going to be outdated like is already, and there's not an easy way to get a video signal that can handle, because it's a 5G thing.
Yeah. Go ahead, Sonny.
Yeah, I mean, if you can even, it's hard to even get them, but I think that's kind of the situation. It's allowing you to, you know, connect newer model with displays with older Macs. So we'd probably have to look more into that.
Yeah, that could solve that problem for people. That would be great. Okay, thanks.
Right. Sure.
Only $200 for that dongle. Oh. All right, anybody else?
Just don't ask me the same
questions about anything that we were mentioning here. Okay.
This is Jody with a quick comment.
All right, Jody, go ahead.
I just think we should all be extremely grateful to to Steve Jobs, because from day one, he wanted everything he made to be accessible. And he's the only company that's ever gone out of their way to do that. So I think we really have to thank him a lot.
Yeah, definitely. All right, very good. Let's see, what do we got coming up next? Okay. Okay, that can only mean that Mr. Herbie Allen is on deck, coming up to bat, actually. And Herbie's got a demo for us. So we'll go ahead and jump right into Herbie's demo.
So what is the number one reason why you should keep your phone in a secure mode? Well, peace of mind, actually. Do you really want somebody to be able to grab your phone and do whatever they want with it? Now, granted, there are some things that can be done even when your phone is not in secure mode. For instance, somebody could actually make phone calls or whatever, but there's a whole lot more that can be done with it. They can download apps onto your phone. If you have your credit card information stored in, like, iTunes, for instance, then they could definitely use it to make purchases without your authorization. Not to mention any other information that is stored on your phone within apps. However, with secure mode, there are some additional things that you can do with your phone in addition to just having some peace of mind. For instance, you can store passwords in Keychain, so that way when you're logging into something on Safari or an application, you don't have to worry about remembering the password. You could just use your Face ID or fingerprint or your phone's passcode to log in to whatever it is you're trying to get into. Again, like I said, you also have peace of mind. Now, if somebody wants to do some things with your phone, they're going to have a much harder time, even if they get your phone while it is in an unlocked state. There's going to be things they cannot do. They cannot change the settings of your phone, for instance. Well, not all of the settings. I do need to clarify that. But there are some secure areas of the phone that do require Face ID or passcode if they are enabled. You can also use Face ID or whatever to protect apps such as banking, cloud storage like Dropbox, and a whole lot more. And so I would say that overall, you are better off with your phone being in secure mode. And then plus, finally, just the fact that you can actually safely store sensitive data on it. So that way, if you need access to anything, it's all right there at your fingertips. And you don't have to worry about somebody being able to easily steal that information. So what can you do with passcodes and Face ID or Touch ID for that matter? I'm going to talk about all three and show you how they work. So let's start with a passcode. You have three different options when it comes to a passcode on your phone. There is the standard four-digit passcode. There is a much more secure six-digit passcode that you can do. However, the most ideal one is the alphanumeric passcode option. You want to do this one, in my opinion, because you can make something that's far more complicated and a lot harder to guess. And so, for instance, my alphanumeric passcode is... sorry guys, I'm not going to tell you. Even though you don't have physical access to my phone, there's just some things I'm not going to share. So there will naturally be some pauses in this recording when I enter in sensitive information like that. So with that, how do we actually get to these goodies? Well, I'm going to show you. We're actually going to go into settings. So why don't we bring that up right now? Open settings.
Settings.
Now, let's just swipe down here because we've got to go a bit of a ways here.
Search. Search field. Herbert Allen. App. Family. Button. Airplane mode. Switch button. Wi-Fi. Fuzzy logic. Bluetooth. On. Button. Cellular. Button. Personal hotspot. Button. Notifications. Button. Sounds and haptics. Button. Focus. Button. Screen time. Button. General. Button. Control center, button, display and brightness, home screen and app, accessibility, wallpaper, button, standby, button, Siri and search, Face ID and passcode, button.
Here we go, Face ID and passcode. If yours is a phone with a fingerprint sensor, it is going to say Touch ID and passcode.
secure text field is editing insertion point at start.
And now I need to enter in my passcode here. So one thing you'll need to know is you cannot actually use your Face ID for this part of the phone. You actually have to use your passcode. So now that I'm in here.
Face ID and passcode. Heading. Use Face ID for. Heading.
So now let's learn what Face ID can actually be used for here.
iPhone unlock. Switch button. Off. iTunes and App Store. Switch button. Off. Wallet and Apple Pay. Switch button. Off.
Now, the reason why these are all saying off is at the moment, I actually do not have Face ID enabled. I am going to actually show you how to set it up as part of this demo.
Password autofill, switch button, off. iPhone can recognize the unique, three-dimensional features of your face to allow secure access to apps and payments. About Face ID and privacy, link. Set up Face ID, button.
So for this part of the demo, I'm going to have to take my headphones off and actually unplug the phone from the mixer. Because I need to be able to hear the phone, and you also need to be able to hear the phone. But what if I have it plugged into the mixer? I will not be able to hear the phone, and I want to have my face unobstructed for this demo.
Use face ID and passcode. Heading.
So I kind of lost focus here.
Require iTunes and app. iPhone can recognize the unique. Set up Face ID button.
Set up Face ID. Here's the button that I want. So I'm going to double tap the button and let's see what we get here.
So cancel button. Have to set up Face ID button. Heading. First, get started. First, position your face in the camera frame. Then move your head in a circle to show all the angles of your face. Get started button.
All right, I'm going to hit the get started button.
Get started button.
So just to give you an idea of what you're going to hear is you're going to hear it making sounds as I'm moving my face around. So I'm going to hold the phone like about a foot away from my face and just kind of hold it center so like it's pointed at my nose. Then we're going to hit the start button.
Position your face within the frame. Head positioned correctly. Starting first scan. 12, 25, 50, 6, 70, 100%.
Now I'm just moving my head up and down, side to side.
Use Face ID with a mask. Heading.
And so just kind of like turning it and it's making its sounds as it's scanning.
About Face ID, use Face ID with a mask. You won't need to wear a mask during setup. Button.
But I do want to use Face ID with a mask. It increases its attention thing.
Use Face ID with position your face within the frame. Heading. 100% completed.
And notice it did tell me that my face was positioned correctly. All right. So now that that's done. Now I'm going to put the phone back into the speaker so we're going to hear it clearer.
Second Face ID scan complete. Heading.
And now this is telling me it's done.
Second Face ID done button.
So I've got a done button to the left of it. I'm going to double tap
done.
That.
Done. Dimmed. Alert. Face ID and voiceover. Face ID has been set up to verify your identity, but not require that you look at iPhone to authenticate. This can be changed in Face ID and passcode settings.
So the nice thing is that we don't have to look precisely at the phone. We have a little bit of flexibility here.
Okay. Button. Wallet and Apple Pay. Settings.
The disadvantage is, yes, if somebody does steal your phone, they could potentially wave it at your face and you wouldn't know it. And so just be mindful of that. If somebody has access to your phone and you don't want them to, make sure you hide your face. All right, so let's start from the top here.
Face ID and passcode. Heading. Use Face ID for. Heading. iPhone unlock. Switch button. On.
iPhone unlock.
iTunes and App Store. Switch button. On.
iTunes and App Store.
Wallet and Apple Pay. Switch button. On. Password autofill. Switch button. On.
So Apple Pay is another thing that you can definitely take advantage of if you're in secure mode because it's a secure way of dealing with credit cards. You don't have to pull out the card. You can use your phone, and so you can wave your phone in front of the scanner if you're at a physical location, or you can use Apple Pay to pay for things online.
Other apps. 10 apps. Button.
Other apps. I want to show you this so you can see which other apps have access to Face ID.
Amazon, switch button, on.
Amazon will use Face ID, not so much for, like, if you're just browsing, but if you're making purchases or logging in.
Apple Store, switch button, on. B of A, switch button, on. CVS, switch button, on. Hilo, switch button, on. PayPal, switch button, on. Starbucks, switch button, on. Wells Fargo, switch button, on. WhatsApp, switch button, on. Zoom, switch button, off. Apps that have requested to use Face ID for authentication will appear here.
So I don't have it on for Zoom, but notice I had several apps in there. There's a health app. There were several banking apps that require my Face ID to be accessed. on my phone.
Face ID and Face ID. Other apps, 10 apps. iPhone can recognize the unique, three-dimensional features of your face to allow secure access to apps and payments. About Face ID and privacy, link. Set up an alternate appearance, button.
I can set up a secondary face if I want.
In addition to continuously learning how you look, Face ID can recognize an alternate appearance.
And you can also use this to add somebody else's face. So if you have a spouse or, you know, somebody like that that you want to have access to your phone, just be careful, though, with a secondary person because you will essentially give them full access.
Face ID with a mask. Switch button. On. Add glasses. Button.
If you have glasses, you can have it scan you with those.
Face ID is most accurate when it's set up for full face recognition only. To use Face ID while wearing a mask, iPhone can recognize the unique features around the eye area to authenticate. You must be looking at your iPhone to use Face ID while wearing a mask. Reset Face ID. Button.
And you can reset your Face ID completely if it's not working too well.
Attention. Heading. Require attention for Face ID. Switch button. Off.
I recommend keeping this off. It requires a more precise view for Face ID. And one other thing I do need to mention about that, if you're going to have somebody sighted help you, they're not going to have VoiceOver on, so make sure you tell them to have the attention turned off or make sure you do it yourself. So it's because I'm using VoiceOver, it automatically recognized I probably do not want this feature activated, and I don't.
True Depth Camera provides an additional level of security by verifying that you're looking at iPhone before authenticating. Attention detection may not work with some sunglasses. Face ID will always require attention when you're wearing a mask. Attention aware features. Switch button. Off. iPhone will check for attention before dimming the display, expanding a notification when locked, or lowering the volume of some alerts. Turn passcode off. Button.
Here's now where you can turn off your passcode.
Change passcode. Button.
You can also change your passcode. By the way, this is the same for phones with fingerprint.
Unlock with Apple Watch. Heading. Herbert's Apple Watch. Aluminum. Series 8. Switch button. On.
I can unlock with my Apple Watch. That really comes in handy sometimes, like if I'm wearing a mask. And so I can just, it'll just use the watch to unlock the phone.
Herbert's Apple Watch. Aluminum. Series 6. Switch button. Off. Alert. Use Herbert's Apple Watch to unlock iPhone if face isn't recognized.
I can turn this on by double tapping the
link
option.
Cancel. Button. Turn on. Button. Alert. Unable to communicate with Apple Watch. Make sure cancel.
And because
button. Try
that
again.
Watch
button.
Is
cancel.
Not
button.
Active, it can't
change.
Confirm
use the
watch.
Require passcode. Void. Mute. Allow. Today. Note. Control. Lock screen widgets. Switch button.
So the last thing I want to talk about is, remember I said there were things you could do with your phone locked that don't require Face ID? Well, you can adjust that here.
Music. Voice. Up. Use the secure connection to your app.
And Herbert, I lost unlock with Apple Watch. Here. Let's
change
password.
Herbert's Apple Watch. Use the secure connection to require passcode immediately. Button.
Require passcode immediately. Nothing actually in there.
Voice dial. Switch button. On. Music voice control is always enabled. Allow access when locked. Heading. Today view and search. Switch button. On.
So you can, if you don't want people to access these things with the phone being locked, you can restrict them.
Notification center. Switch button. On. Control center. Switch button. On. Lock screen widgets. Switch button. On. Live activities. Switch button. On. Siri. Switch button. On. Reply with message. Switch button. On. Home control. Switch button. On. Wallet. Switch button. Off. Return missed calls. Switch button. On.
You know what? I
accessories.
Think I do want
switch button.
My...
Turn off to prevent accessories from erase data. Switch button. Erase. Turn. Wallet.
Focus.
Home control. Wallet. Switch button. Off. On.
There. So I've now turned it on. So you can. You have to have a Face ID to access my wallet.
Return missed calls. Thank you. Switch button. On.
Not anybody can return my missed calls.
Accessories. Switch button. On. Turn off to prevent accessories from connecting when your iPhone has been locked for more than an hour. Erase data. Switch button. On. Erase all data on this iPhone after 10 failed passcode attempts. Data protection is enabled.
And if we double tap
erase
this,
data. Off.
We can turn it off or on.
Alert. Enable. Button. Cancel. Button. Cancel. Enable. All data on this iPhone will be erased after 10 failed passcode attempts. Enable. Button.
Okay, you still
erase
let
data.
You be able
switch
to
button.
Change that.
Erase all data. Erase all data on this iPhone after.
And that's it. Now, the last question is, what phones support Face ID? iPhone 10 and above. And, if you are using an SE model, though, you are still on the fingerprint sensor. And now we're going to take a quick look at how that works. So for the next part of this demonstration, I'm going to be switching phones here. So you're going to hear a completely different phone. And also, I will mention real quick that the passcode that it's going to mention is not 1234 or 123456, but I'm only telling you what it is not. So one thing I will mention real quick, in case there's any major differences that I'm unaware of, which I don't think there will be, this phone is running iOS 15, but if you're running something newer, there really shouldn't be any differences. So we're going to go to
wallpaper button, Siri and search button.
to
touch ID and passcode.
Button. Touch ID and passcode.
Passcode. Zero of values entered.
And I'm going to enter in the passcode. So here we're going to see our similar settings to what we saw on the other thing with Face ID.
Use Touch ID for iPhone unlock, iTunes and app, wallet and app, password, fingerprints, finger one, button.
So here's the differences. Now we can see whether we got fingerprints on here.
Fingerprints, heading, finger one, button, finger two, button, add a fingerprint, button.
So I'm going to add in a fingerprint.
Add a finger. Cancel, button.
And I'm just going to
place your finger. Heading. Lift and rest your finger on the home button repeatedly. A fingerprint that changes color during the setup process. Recognition is 0% complete. A fingerprint that changes color during the setup process.
Alright, so one advantage is I don't have to take off headphones, that's for sure. Alright, I'm just going to use my thumb.
A fingerprint that changes color during the setup process. Recognition, lift your finger. Place your finger. A fingerprint that, lift your finger. Place your finger. A fingerprint that, lift your finger. Place your finger. A fingerprint that, lift your finger. Place your finger. Lift. Right, cancel.
To where it'll read less.
Lift your finger. Place your finger. Lift your finger. Place your finger. Lift your finger. Place your finger. Lift your finger. Place your finger.
Gets a little monotonous, in my opinion.
Photo of a person holding. Adjust your grip. Keep going to capture the edges of your. Continue. Button.
Now, I will mention this is on cancel, an iPhone 7, button. So it could be a bit of a smoother process on some of the SE models. I don't know.
Place your finger. Heading. Lift your finger. Place your finger. 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 Lift your finger. Place your finger.
So notice Face ID was done a lot quicker.
Touch ID is ready. A finger. Continue. Button. Continue.
But you can add in multiple fingerprints, and there you go. So that's the difference with adding in a fingerprint versus Face ID, depending on your phone model. And there you go. So that's how you do security on your phone. So why not give it a try? Now, just a couple minor things I will address. I did get an interesting question from somebody when I was talking about Face ID. Will it work if you have a prosthetic? And I will say that I don't know of any reason why perhaps it wouldn't, because it uses your whole face, not just your eyes. But that is a very interesting question and one that I definitely need to look into more. But I would say that at least give it a try and see if it works or not. The worst that'll happen is they'll say, oh, nope, can't do it. And, you know, it'll just say, can't recognize your face. So some of these things you just got to give a try. No, it will not say alien or anything like that. And is it more secure to use a passcode versus Face ID or Touch ID? Which one is more secure? That is always going to be a very interesting question. And passcode, in a lot of respects, could be the most secure if you don't let other people overhear it. But Face ID and Touch ID are definitely more convenient. But that being said, Face ID, it's only going to work if somebody has access to your face. Or likewise with Touch ID, you know, you can, I guess if somebody, well, we won't go there, but there's ways Touch ID could be manipulated. That being said, Touch ID has the advantage of, you know, you can unlock your phone while it's in your pocket, for instance, but it has a disadvantage. For those of you that are living in colder climates, you can't unlock your phone while wearing gloves, whereas Face ID, you know, you have a little bit more flexibility. So we won't go into which one is better, but there are some key differences in how they operate. So a couple of the minor things I did not get into real quick on that recording is, one, where is the fingerprint sensor if your phone supports that? It is on the circle button at the bottom that you would use like to activate Siri. So that is a circle button on your phone. And if your phone is a Face ID phone, then it's the type of model that doesn't have a home button. The other thing I did not get around is to showing you how quick it is to use Face ID to unlock your phone. So I'm going to do that real quick.
1457. Three notifications. There you go. Messages. My phone OCR unlocked. Folder. Five apps.
Just like that. So that's how smooth Face ID can be. And with that, we can take questions.
Okay. Man, you surprised me there. I thought the thing had ended and you seamlessly jumped right in and picked right up. I couldn't tell the difference.
All right, very good, Herbie. Yeah, we're going to unmute and see if folks have questions for Herbie on any of the things he covered today.
This is Terry.
Yes.
Am I understanding you correctly that none of the, let's see, how should I say this? The phones that do not have a home button do not have touch ID capability.
Correct.
Is that right?
That is correct. Okay. There have been rumors that there's been rumor mills about under the display touch ID, but at the moment that has strictly been rumors. But no, if your phone does not have a home button, it does not have touch ID.
I'm surprised that they haven't come up with that, because some of their competitors have, and you know, in terms of Android phones. So I'm just kind of surprised, but all right. Thank you.
All right.
This is
Tree. Yes.
So Herbie, I've got a question. So when Face ID fails and you're prompted to enter the digits, is there a quick way to have it do the Face ID again?
So you can try to, if you don't do too many attempts, you can always just lock the phone and unlock it and then give it another try. If you're in an app that's failing to recognize your Face ID, there is a try again button that you can double tap and then move your finger away and try your Face ID. So yes, you can. And after so many failed Face ID attempts, you're strictly limited to your passcode. So.
And I'm sorry, you said the first thing is to lock it. You said relock the phone?
Lock the phone and unlock it. Yeah.
Okay. And then I think from my understanding, it does work with prosthetic eyes.
Yes, it doesn't have to be an eye for an eye or something along those lines. So awesome.
This is Marty.
Yes, Marty.
Herbie, is it unusual, or I cannot, when I hit the lock button to unlock it, Face ID will not work. I have to go to the home like thing, swipe up to home, and then Face ID will work for me.
Huh, no, I'm able to do it right from the lock screen.
Yeah, no, when I do it from the unlock screen, it says, you know, face not recognized, try again. And then when I swipe up to home, then for the most part, I have to turn my head a little bit back and forth, and then it recognizes my face.
So there's two things that could be going on here. One, I think it's the aim, I suspect it's the aim of your camera. So really make focus on how you're pointing your phone, because it needs to be right at your face, you know, and just try to hold it away a little bit. Two, I would also do the reset face option and then have it rescan your face and see if that makes a difference.
Okay.
All right.
Thanks.
Any other questions?
This is Richard in Houston.
Yes.
Herbie, how many face profiles can you set up?
Two. If,
for example, I might wear glasses in one and not wear glasses in another.
I believe you're just limited to two.
Thank you.
Welcome.
All right, time for one more question.
David.
Yes.
Yeah, I found with the Face ID, even though it says it doesn't require attention, you still have to be looking in like the general direction of the phone. I mean, you can't just be looking off in space and have your phone like at a 90-degree angle from your. You have to be, somewhat in your attention.
Yes.
Yeah, and one thing I've done, I don't know if it's just frustration, but sometimes if it doesn't work the first time, I'll lock it and I'll shake the phone, and it seems to work. But that might be superstition on my part, but. It makes me feel better.
You know, it makes you feel better, so that's good enough, right?
All right, very good.
Just like you're not smashing it. So.
All right, we're going to let Vincent sneak in here for one more question, then we've got to move on.
Would it be possible for somebody to use a photograph of your face?
That is an interesting question. I think not, because I think there's some kind of interaction with the actual face, but then again, I guess there could be factors too, like the quality of the photograph, for instance. I mean,
This is Sandhya.
Yes.
I think it uses infrared to make a map of your face. That's what it's doing. So I think a picture wouldn't work.
Yeah, I agree with that. Just one hint on when you first set up your face scan, sometimes people have trouble with it. And someone had told me a pretty easy way to think about doing that facial, you know, rotating your face around. So, you know, like Herbie said, holding the camera or your phone camera out 18 inches away from you or so, and then pretend you have a large clock and kind of start up looking up at the 12 and then just go around looking at each of the numbers, you know, slowly making a circle, looking at all the numbers around the face of the clock. And then it pretty much always gets the scan in. All right. Very good, Herbie. We are moving right along. So thanks to Herbie for that great little... All right, so I got top of the hour here, and we are going to take a little pause here. And for those folks that came in after we did the initial introductions, we would love to have you tell us who you are and where you're from. Just jump right in and say your name, where you're from. You didn't get a chance the first time around. I know there's somebody out there.
Oh, yeah. They're unmuted now. Go ahead.
Oh, anybody? You muted them back. Okay. Who hasn't gone? Introductions that didn't get
to... This is David from Houston.
All right. Welcome, David.
How about the icebreaker, sir?
This is Ed from Georgetown.
Ed from Georgetown. Oh yeah, let's hang on just a second. We did have a little icebreaker. Halloween's coming up. We would like for you to share with us what is your least favorite Halloween treat. Least favorite. Ed, and then go back to David.
From my cousin Texas.
This is David. Least favorite are probably candy corn, I think.
All right. You joined in with a lot of people from the first time. And go ahead, Ed.
I would say gum.
Okay. You were the only gum so far. Very good. Anybody else out there that didn't get to introduce themselves?
Hi, it's Carla from the UK.
Yes, Carla.
Hello. Pumpkin, because I think it's pretty tasteless, to be honest.
Oh wow, okay. So no pumpkin spice anything. Okay, all right, well, we are certainly welcome, we are very glad to have you again back with us. Okay, who else we got out there?
This is Frank from Missouri City.
All right, Frank, welcome, sir. Oh, what's your least favorite Halloween treat? Least favorite?
Candy corn.
All right. Anybody else that didn't get to introduce themselves? I see a few other names out there on the list. You can just jump, unmute yourself and jump right in. Okay, we got a shy bunch out there, I guess.
Okay, Cindy from Chicago. I forgot to hit the got it button. It got me.
Oh, yes. Yeah, we're recording this.
So I don't like those corn balls. They're like...
Oh, the popcorn balls.
Yeah, I don't like those.
Okay, well, welcome, Cindy. Where are you from again?
Hold up.
Okay, Cindy went away. All right, anybody else?
He's from Chicago.
I'm from Chicago.
He's from Chicago. Is this your first
Chicago.
Time? Is this your first time to be at this meeting, Cindy?
At this meeting, yes.
Okay, well, we are certainly glad to have you. Which other meetings have you been to?
The movies. I was at the movies last night.
Oh, okay. Very good. Well,
keep coming back. We'd love to have you. Anyone else?
Yes, Clarice.
Oh, hey, Clarice.
Hey. And I hate cotton, corn candy.
All right. And joining the club of the candy corn. Anyone else? Okay, then we are going to move right along. I know Sandhya said we're not going to do this, but I think I'm going to override her. And we are going to have a door prize. I don't have my door prize music keyed up, but we are going to have a door prize. See how well people were listening to the Apple news and rumors earlier. So let's see. Earlier, Sandhya mentioned that there is an iPhone that is covered with diamonds, or a girl's best friend. I would like to know, she said, how many diamonds there were.
Just remember who's eligible.
Oh, yes. If you are a iBUG facilitator or mentor, then you are ineligible to play. Sorry, this is just for other participants. So come off mute. Carol.
Is it 7,000?
That's in the ballpark. I'm looking for it. You got to get it within 100. 7,000. So take a guess at what hundred, how many hundreds of in there?
7,500.
Wait a minute. I was asking Carol.
Oh, sorry.
Oh, Carol. How many hundreds?
7,000 and how many hundreds?
Okay. Well, the other guy said it. 7,500.
7,500. It was, I believe, 7,586. So that's within 100. And Carol gets our door prize, which is a, what is it? Wait, I got to go talk to the judges. What do we have for Carol? No? Oh,
no?
Okay. You sure? Okay. Carol, guess what?
You are
going to get 7,500 candy corn. No. We will get a $25 Apple gift card.
Oh, really? Okay.
That will be coming to you virtually via email. So look for that next day.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much. Carol. All right. Who is next on the agenda? I don't know. Okay, here I got my agenda up and looks like we got. Hello. All right, that means we have Terry Ann coming up. Terry Ann, do you want to introduce what you're going to be demoing today?
I think it's already in the recording, so you're probably good to go with that.
Okay, we'll jump right into the demo.
Hello, everyone. Today we're going to talk about an app which is used not only with the iPhone but with many other devices nowadays called WhatsApp. But we're going to explore the question of what's up with WhatsApp as it specifically relates to the iPhone. And in particular, we're going to look at the chat menu because that is the most involved menu. And since this is a chat platform, that's the one that we need to know how to use. So Let's now take a look at what's up with WhatsApp.
Chats, 21 items, tab, 4 of 5.
I'm going to double tap there.
Selected, chats, 21 items, tab, 4 of...
So now we're in the chats tab itself, and it says 21 items. What it's telling me is that I have 21 chat groups or individuals whose messages I haven't read recently. But the one chat group that I want to talk about is the iBUG chat group that I established here, I believe, about just over 3 years ago. It's hard to believe that it's been that long ago. Before I actually get into the chat group itself,
more.
There's a more button here. Let's take a look at what's in here.
Group chat round small. Image. People. iBUG buzz. Mute. Button.
I'm swiping to the right now.
Group info. Button. Clear chat. Button. Exit group. Button. Cancel. Button.
So this tells you different things that you can do with this chat group.
Clear chat. Button. Group info. Button. Mute. Button.
And if I double tap on that one.
Mute notifications. Other participants will not see that you muted this chat, and you will still be notified if you are mentioned. 8 hours. Button.
So I could mute this chat group for 8 hours if I wanted to.
1 week. Button.
I could mute this chat group so I wouldn't receive notifications about it when a message comes in for a week.
Always. Button.
Or always. It used to be 1 year, but now they've changed that to always. And so if I double tap on always and select that one, I won't see any notifications or hear any notifications regarding messages that have come in to the iBUG Buzz chat group. And so if I'm going to find out if I've received any messages, I actually have to come here and see if I have unread messages. So to get out of this menu, I have to flick all the way to the right to cancel. So now I'm going to go to the beginning of my chat list, the very beginning of my chat list. I'm wanting to show you what is in the menu structure when you are in the chat tab before I actually open a chat group. So the very first thing all the way to the left.
Edit. Chats. Edit.
Is an edit button. And if I want to go in there, I could go in there and do a search. I could do any number of things there. So, but I'm going to flick to the right.
Chats. Heading.
Okay.
Camera. Button. New chat. Button. Search. Search field. Double tap to edit. Unread filter. Button. Archived chats. Button. Broadcast list. New group. Button. Terry Ann Sorman.
And you're... now I'm to my list of chat groups, and mine is the first one here. So I want to go back to new chat for just a minute, and I'm going to double tap on that.
New chat. Heading. New AI chat. Button.
New AI chat. And this is, I believe, a relatively new thing. WhatsApp has been making all kinds of additions to what it can do as an app. There are updates. Oh my goodness. It seems like there's a new update for WhatsApp almost every 2 weeks or so. So it will be interesting to see what this option allows one to do. I have not played with it yet, but it is a newer option.
Edit button.
Again, we're now at the beginning of the list of items and chat groups. So I'm flicking to the right.
Chats, heading, camera, button, new chat, button, search field, unread filter, button, archived chats, button, broadcast lists, button, new group, button, Terry Ann Sorman,
And now we get to my list of chat groups. So now I am going to do a search for iBUG and let's see what we get here. Now let's see what happens if we do search results. So we come up with several names associated with iBUG. It somehow knows that, but then we came up to with iBUG Buzz. I did a touch and explore and I moved my finger up the screen and lo and behold, there is the iBUG Buzz group. So I'm going to double tap on that.
Group icon, button.
Now I'm going to swipe to the right again.
iBUG Buzz, participants, Michael, Sandhya, you, heading.
And now it tells me who the participants in this group are. And if I had, let's say, 50 or 100 participants in a group, which happens a lot, it would give me a couple of names, but then it would give me the option of double tapping to see who all the people, the names of all of the people in the group.
Video call button.
So now I could, from here, I could make a video call to somebody in this group.
Voice call button.
I could just make a voice call, as in a telephone call to somebody in this group.
You created group iBUG today, July 25, 2020 at 3:23 p.m.
There we go. It was named iBUG today back then.
Messages and calls are end-to-end encrypted. No one outside of this chat, not even WhatsApp, can read or listen to them. July 25. 2020 at 3:23 p.m. messages and calls are end-to-end encrypted. Your voice message. Duration, 4 minutes, 49 seconds. July 26, 2020 at 9:36 p.m. Send. Current position, 0 seconds. 4 minutes, 49 seconds.
There's my first message, and I could double tap to play this. There are also other things that I can do at this point before I even open it to play it. If I swipe down.
Skip backward.
All right. If I flick down again.
Start. Reply. Forward. React.
That would be like putting a smiley face or a heart. There are different things you can put here. And people will see those.
Info. Delete. Skip forward. Activate. Default. Skip backward.
They're all the things you can do with this message without even opening it up. One of the wonderful features that they added to WhatsApp about a year or more ago is the ability to play the message at different speeds. You have three options. So let's see if I can find that field here. I'm swiping to the right.
2x speed button.
So right now it's at the 2x speed button. So if I double tap on it.
Normal speed button. 1.5x speed button. 2x speed button.
So it's interesting all the things you can do within a particular message once you've opened it and you're playing it or you have it paused. The beautiful thing is that if you're recording a message, you can also pause that recording now and you need to think about something or run and get something or the doorbell rings, you can pause your message and then come back to the recording and resume that recording.
Vertical scroll bar, 6 pages, 99%, adjustable.
Now I'm going to flick to the right again.
Share media, button. Compose message, text field. Double tap to edit. Use the rotor to access misspelled words.
That would allow me to write out the message, and I would have options of dictating the message, and it would write it out. Or I could double tap on it and type that message, either on this on-screen keyboard or with an external keyboard. So I have both of those options there. Now we'll swipe to the right again.
Stickers and GIFs, button. Camera, button. Voice message, button. Double tap and hold to record. Release to send or slide left to cancel. Double tap and slide up to lock recording.
So now if I want to leave a voice message here, this gives me the options of what I can do. So I'm going to leave a voice message. So I'm going to do a double tap and hold. And then because I want to lock my microphone so that when I take my finger away from the screen, the recording won't stop. So I'm going to double tap and hold.
Recording locked.
And I have slid my finger up just an inch or two on the screen to lock my recording. I no longer have my hand on the screen, and it is still recording. If I want to do something with this message while I'm recording it, I have to go to the bottom of the screen.
1:16.
And I'm going to swipe to the left.
Your voice message. Duration, 4 minutes. Vertical
scroll. There was my last message. So now I'm swiping to the right.
1:28.
So it's telling me here how much time has elapsed since I started this recording. So now I'm going to swipe to the right again at the bottom of the screen.
Pause button. Pause. Today is the first day of the rest of your life. Button.
And so now I've paused the message, but it's also taken me to a greeting that I have typed in here instead of the word send. So that when I end a recording, the people who are listening to this recording won't hear the word send, but they'll hear my little phrase here that says today is the first day of the rest of your life. Okay, so I'm going to swipe to the right.
Cancel button. Resume button.
And there's the good old resume button.
Resume button.
Okay, that's all the way to the right. So now I'm going to resume the recording.
Resume. Pause button.
So now I know that I'm recording again because you heard the iPhone say pause.
2:04.
So now I've been recording for 2 minutes and 4 seconds. Swipe to the left.
Your voice message. Duration, 4 minutes.
And there's my previous message. So now I'm going to swipe to my right.
Vertical scroll bar. 2:24. Pause button. Today is the first day of the rest of your life. Button.
And I'm going to double tap on this, which will end the message.
Voice message button.
And you heard it. Maybe you heard it make a little popping sound now to let me know that it has sent the message. So if Sandhya or Michael wanted to listen to this message, they could because I have sent it. However, I sent this message. I didn't cancel it, but I don't want to keep it. So now I'm going to swipe back to the left.
Compose message. Text field. Camera. Button. Stickers and GIFs. Share media. button. Go to most recent message. Button. Go to most recent. Your voice message. Duration. 2 minutes. 36 seconds. 10:53 a.m. Delivered to recipients. Current position. 0 seconds. 2 minutes. 36 seconds.
So I could play this message, but I'm not going to, because I want to delete it. I already know that I want to delete this message. So I'm going to swipe down.
Skip backward. Star. Reply. Forward. React. Info. Delete.
So I want to delete this message. So I'm going to double tap on it.
Your voice message. Duration. 2 minutes. 36 seconds. 10:53 a.m. Delivered to recipients. Current position. 0 seconds. 2 minutes. 36 seconds. Selected.
All right. So now I'm going to swipe to the right.
Vertical scroll bar. Toolbar. Delete. Button.
So I know I want to delete this message, but let's see if there's anything else here.
One selected.
So it's told me that this message has been selected because I had already pressed the delete button. So I'm going to swipe back to the left.
Delete button.
Okay.
Delete message?
Yes, okay. It's asking me, do I really want to delete this message? So now I'm going to swipe to my right.
Delete for everyone. Button.
So because I am the owner and an administrator of this group, it gives me the option to delete for everyone, or if I swipe to the right,
delete for me. Button.
Delete for me. And I want to, because I can, I want to delete this for everyone. If I were just a group participant, I would not have the option to delete for everyone. This is a feature that they added quite some time ago. And frankly, it is a good feature because once in a while you get messages from people that maybe aren't so appropriate to a group for whatever the reason might be. And you can delete that message for everyone. So that's what I'm going to do here.
Delete for everyone. Button.
I'm going to double tap.
21. Back button.
And it's now gone.
Group icon. 21. Back button. Camera. Button. Stickers and GIFs. Share media. Go to most recent message. Message. You deleted this message. 10:53 a.m.
So it's
sent to iBUG.
It's telling me that I deleted this message. I could undelete it if I wanted to, but I don't want to. And so if I don't undelete it within a few seconds, I think, then it will eventually go away. And so now I'm to the previous message that I've had here for forever. And so it is now the most recent message that I have here because I deleted this other one that I had just recorded a few minutes ago.
Message. You deleted this message. Okay. 10:53 a.m. Sent to iBUG Buzz. Delivered to recipients.
Yep. Okay. But they don't have it anymore. I don't really have it anymore. I think it eventually will go away. And it might even later on tell me that I deleted this message, or if I wanted to, I could delete several messages. So it'll say you deleted 16 messages, whatever the number happens to be. So if you want to delete more than one message, you can first go down to the one you want to delete and then double tap on it. Go to that delete option, double tap on that one. And then you could swipe to your left or to your right, depending upon where you are in your string of messages. And when you double tap on those messages, they will be selected so they can be deleted. They won't start playing, but that's a fast way to delete several messages at a time if you want to do that. So this is the extent of what I'm going to show you in chat. As I say, it is primarily the feature that I use most often. And I love WhatsApp. I've made some good friends because of WhatsApp. I've been able to help people out with their braille displays and other electronic devices. I've learned a whole lot of things in WhatsApp because of messages I've received in the various chat groups to which I belong. So I personally think WhatsApp is a great, great feature. Some people don't like it because of privacy issues, because you have to have a phone number associated with it when you're using it on your iPhone. But I absolutely love it. And if you take the necessary precautions, you won't get these awful messages, spam messages, whatever. You won't get messages from people from whom you don't want to be receiving them. So I think we'll end our discussion of WhatsApp here, but now I will be very happy to entertain any questions that you might have about WhatsApp. And so I will send this back to you, Sandhya and Michael. Take it away.
All right. What a great presentation, Terry Ann. Really appreciate you doing that. Let's see. We're going to unmute and see if anyone has questions for Terry about
this is Herbie.
What's that? Go ahead.
This is Dan.
All right, Herbie, then Dan.
Just a couple things. So first of all, if you're concerned about your phone number, you can always use something like a Google Voice number, just so long as it, you know, because it can receive texts for verification purposes. So I thought I'd mention that. Also, one thing I will mention when it comes to deleting messages, if it's your message, you actually can delete it for everybody. You can't, if you're not a group admin, you can't delete like anybody else's message. But if it's your message, you can delete it for everybody. So I just thought I'd mention that as well.
Okay. Dan, I think you were next.
Yes. Thank you, Terry. Excellent, excellent demonstration. I've been curious about WhatsApp for a long time. My questions are these. Number one is there any monetary cost for this app? And number two, are there any accessibility issues that I should be aware of?
There are no monetary costs for WhatsApp at this time. There were rumors for a while that they were going to charge, but they have not yet, and I'm thinking that is not going to happen for a while. Of course, just because I just now said that, I hope I haven't jinxed myself. It is part of Facebook, or whatever the new Meta or whatever the new name of it is. But at this point, there are no costs associated that I'm aware of. Now, for businesses, because there's also a business WhatsApp, there might be, but I'm not sure about that either. And then, I'm sorry, your second question.
Were there any accessibility issues that I should be aware of?
I would say, no, I can't think of any offhand. Now, if somebody else may have some thoughts or some experiences with that, but nothing just comes to mind for me at this point. Yes, Herbie.
The big thing I can think of is if you're trying to use WhatsApp on another device, like an iPad, and it wants the QR code, that can be a little bit interesting because you have to wave your phone in front of the like iPad screen or whatever. So that can be a little bit of an interesting thing there. But
and actually, if I can comment on that, I actually have been able to do that very successfully, not with with an iPad, but with another device that has a screen, which we won't mention. But yeah. I think, therefore, that if it works for that, I think you won't have a problem. Well, you shouldn't have a problem waving it in front of your phone in front of your iPad to get that, to capture that QR code as well, because it really works very well. and I have no vision whatever.
This is Carla with another comment regarding secondary devices with WhatsApp. You can also now use WhatsApp with the same phone number. You just need to tell it that you want to use the phone number and put in your phone number with that account in. And so you can have it on several different devices and not even worry about a QR code anymore.
Yes, good point. It was interesting. They started with a QR code, and then again, when they put in some more features, they added that feature. So you're absolutely right. Thank you. May I just say, we don't use the raised hand feature here. So if you do want to ask a question, if you can unmute yourself and state your name and wait to be recognized, and we'll be glad to do so.
Raul Rojas from Manhattan, Texas.
Yes, Raul. Welcome. What's your question or comment?
Yes. Where's the option about the new AI chat?
I'm sorry, what is the question about the AI chat?
AI chat, yes.
Yes. I have not played with it yet, so I don't know. I don't know anything about it. I just recently discovered it, and I do need to play with it. It's in the WhatsApp app. I know I've found it, and I now am drawing a blank. I have to go back and listen to my demo to figure out where to remember where it is. I guess
that's fine.
I can't remember just where it is in there, but I know it is in there. I can go look in a minute, and if we have time before we end this meeting, I'll come back and let you know. How about that?
Thank you so much.
Mm-hmm.
All right, very good. Any other questions on WhatsApp?
This is Ed.
Go ahead.
Yes, Ed.
Yeah, I'm just curious. When WhatsApp first came out, it had just the absolute best encryption available. Does it still have that?
Yes.
Even on Facebook, like that version of it?
I don't know what you're referring to as in terms of WhatsApp in Facebook.
Well, that's what I thought you said something about it was owned by Facebook.
It is.
Okay.
It is.
That's what I'm referring to.
Yes. So, yes. Oh, yeah. Its encryption capabilities, regardless of how it's used, where it's used, are really very, very good.
Okay. Thank you.
And they have disclaimers about that, you know, within WhatsApp on your iPhone, on your iPad, wherever. So they make sure you're very aware of that. Because mm-hmm. even they cannot get to your messages. They make that point now very clear as well.
This is Jake. I have a question.
Yes, Jake.
Is the, like the WhatsApp, is that HD, you know, phone calls, is it high quality?
You mean the quality of the chat itself, the recording, the recorded message that you leave for somebody?
Well, yeah, that. And what about like audio calls? Do you know anything about that?
Oh, yes. I've used audio calls with WhatsApp, like in person, or as they like to say in the UK, proper chats, you know, where you talk to one another in real time as you would on a telephone call. Or like right. we're doing right now. They are very clear. Yes. The sound is good. The connections are good. And they even give you the option when you're done with the call, when you hang up the call or release it to rate it. And, you know, how was this call? Was it successful? So you can let them know if you had any issues or if it was a great call. But most of the calls that I have been on, and it has been many using WhatsApp, have been very good. As far as the sound goes in terms of the recorded messages that you leave, the sound is good, but I have to say there are other message platforms out there where you can leave recorded messages for people where the sound quality is a lot better. But it is good. I mean, I almost never have an issue with understanding the person. And if there is a problem with that, it's more because of the microphone they're using and not on WhatsApp's end of the call or end of the recording, I should say.
This is Richard in Houston.
Yes, Richard, go ahead.
Is there any way that the WhatsApp application or operators will block those who engage in bad behavior? I mean, people who are abusive, people who use bad language, or is that taken care of at the group level? Or is it taken care of at all?
It is taken care of. You now can, and I didn't find it in, and so I'm glad you brought this up. I did not find that feature in the iBUG chat group. But I wonder if it's because it's an older, you know, we started that group in 2020. There is now a way that an administrator can not only delete unwanted messages, but I believe the administrator of the group can also block that person from participating in that group. And there is a way to report abuse to the WhatsApp team of Facebook. I have done that in the past, not recently, but I have done it. And to my knowledge, they didn't do anything about it. So I think they pretty much now leave it up to the individual group moderators to address those issues. But I think if there was something really, really serious, hopefully there is a way to be in touch with them. And I would do it if I needed to, and hopefully could then follow up with them about something like that.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Sounds like it'd be very similar to, you know, here on Zoom. We have to monitor it ourselves, and we can block or kick people out of the main room here and then report them. Okay, any other questions for Terry Ann? All right. Well, very good, Terry Ann. That was such an awesome presentation. It's like the world flying through the air, just to make you small. Dipping and whispers in and out. Thank you very much. And you all asked some wonderful questions. And now I'm going to go find that AI thing and see if I can get to it before we end the call, and I'll get back to you.
Okay, sounds good. We still have a little bit of time if there happen to be any other questions back for Herbie's presentation. Welcome to jump in and ask that, or if you just have any general questions, we will try to entertain those. I hear somebody off mic. Are you trying to ask a question? Say your name. Okay. Sandhya, are you still there?
Yes.
Do you have any additional things that you would like to share with the group?
Oh, one of the news articles that I forgot to include because I got carried away with the diamonds. So there was something about how Amazon, now we have something called passkeys. We were kind of talking about it in our recent Monday night call, so we're going to have to explore that because apparently Amazon will now allow you to use pass keys to access their, I mean, I know Herbie mentioned that on his thing, but somehow pass keys are a newer form of security. So we're going to have to, I'm eager to check that out. I just learned about it this morning, so.
Okay.
Jake, I have a comment.
Yeah, go ahead, Jake.
Yeah, I heard that too about pass keys, and I think Google's going to start doing it too, if they haven't started already.
Yes. And
I know what it is. I can tell you.
Go ahead.
Pass key is basically an image. It uses an image that's stored in your phone to is your password to basically authenticate your login. And the only thing I don't know is, because you can still do your password, but it says that you can delete your password if you want to. But one thing I don't know is, like, if you used a Windows computer, how the passkey would translate over to that.
Okay. Yeah, that's one thing they mentioned on there is, yeah, this would eliminate the need to keep remembering those passwords that we make up and all that nonsense. It would really obviate the need to have all those things. So it makes
that's what it is.
Yeah. So very cool.
Thanks. I use it for something, and I don't know the name of the app, but I use it and it's fine. Oh, you know what it's for? I think it's for Robinhood.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Very good. Thanks, Jake. Great. Yeah, comments. Appreciate that.
Thank you.
This is Sri.
Go ahead, Sri.
Just out of curiosity, questions. You know, you mentioned about AirTags, and you know, I have a few of them, but all the AirTags that I've had, most of them don't work now. And I'm just trying to figure out: have you guys had that problem where, after like the first replacement of the battery, then I can't seem to get it to work anymore?
This is Sandhya. I've only been through one replacement of the battery, but I do get notifications of, you know, something has been left behind or that pretty regularly. So I have not really had that experience, I don't think.
This is Herbie.
Go ahead, Herbie.
So first of all, I do have all four of my original AirTags and they're working fine. But one thing that can trigger off new notifications is if you upgrade or reset your phone. I had a scary moment the other day. I had to reset my phone and I got notifications of AirTags that were near me. I was like, what? Oh, wait a minute. These are mine. But you're confused as to whether this is an existing device or whatever. So there's things like that that can always throw things off. But what is coming to my mind, though, is, and I don't know if this is similar to your problem, Sri, but I remember helping Sandhya with this several months ago where she had to replace the battery and like it was not taking it, and I think there was you finally got it to work later on, or
yeah, I remember that. You have great memory. Yeah, I couldn't get it to pair and then eventually it did. I don't know, so you could maybe unpair, but yeah, you don't want to unpair because then it can't find. It was some weird issue like that.
This is Sri.
Yeah.
The real question I'm asking is like, so the battery's dead. I replace the battery. I can never get, you know, I don't get the audible alert to say that it recognized the battery. It's almost like it's like dead. Like I've not gotten any of my old ones, you know, after the battery died, put a new battery in. I'm like very few. I have a very high failure rate. You know, maybe like 1 out of 4 will work, but the rest are all, they're just dead.
So it doesn't even recognize the AirTag anymore?
No. Like the it doesn't recognize the battery, it doesn't recognize anything.
Oh wow.
This is Sandhya. Are you getting the tone when you initially put the battery in?
Mm-mm. It's like it's dead.
Okay. Because I had a lot of trouble putting that in there, positioning it and closing it. So maybe something really basic. I mean, I'm sure you tried and you've done it many times, but I don't know, that's really odd.
Yeah, I was just going to take the whole bunch of them just to the Apple Store and see if they can figure out.
Yeah, that's what I was going to suggest. Have a genius check it out and see what might be happening there. That's not normal behavior. It should, you know, once batteries are replaced. I think I've replaced one battery. I didn't have any issues with it. You might try David's thing, shake them a little bit.
Yes, I like that.
Well, this is Sri. What David said actually did make sense to me, because sometimes I do shake my phone when the password fails and I'm on the keypad to enter my password. When I shake it, it's almost like there's some sensor getting regenerated because my phone vibrates.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So It does recognize my Face ID that way.
Yeah, it messes around with the accelerometers. Does something to correct itself. Okay.
Okay, so this is Cindy from Chicago. I have okay. A question.
Yeah, Cindy, go ahead.
The host keeps muting me. Okay, I thought I fixed this problem, and I guess I haven't because I'm still having this issue. So when I finish with a phone call, when I double tap to hang up the call, I am getting that music. So what I have to do to get rid of that?
All right. Anybody have ideas for Cindy?
The magic. This is Richard.
Yeah, Richard, go ahead.
Go to the app switcher and close your music app. That will probably take care of it.
This is Cindy. My music app is not open. It's totally closed. I know I talked to someone else about it. They say delete the music app, but I'm not using it, so why would I delete it?
No, just close it in the app switcher.
Right. I think she's saying it's not even open.
But it's not open at all.
Are you sure? Have you looked in the app switcher?
Yep.
Okay.
This is Sri.
Go ahead, Sri.
Yeah, I think, you know, what you're experienced, I've experienced it too, whether it's music or a book. I think what it's doing is it's running in the back end. That's why you don't see the music app running. And the only thing that I usually do is I'll do another two-finger double tap to stop it.
Right. That's what I have to do. But it's a pain, especially when you're in a hurry and you just want to hang up the car and keep moving, you know what I'm saying?
I mean, that's the only way that I know of, because I can't seem to figure out what is triggering it to run it in the background, except that I've listened to it some time ago.
Cindy, so how do you turn it off in the background? Is there a way to do that?
You could try a reboot.
Yeah, I tried that.
Yeah, it's one of those bugs that is just kind of hitting this.
Okay, thanks.
This is Sri. Did you do a force reboot or a reboot?
Yeah, I just did reboot. Just told Siri to reboot.
Yeah, I would do a force reboot, not a reboot.
Okay. All right, thank you. I'll try that.
And remind us again, Sri, how do you do the force reboot?
You press the volume up, then volume down, and then hold the side button. I hold it for about 17 seconds. It's been said, you know, you hold it till the Apple logo comes on. Since I can't see it, I counted around 17 seconds or so, and then you can release it.
Okay, thank you.
All right, very good.
This is Terry.
Yeah, Terry.
I have the answer to the question that the gentleman from, I think, Texas asked. I'm sorry, I've forgotten your name, sir.
Raul. About
Raul, yes, right. I love his name because you can roll your R. Yes, Raul. Anyway. So to get to this AI chat in WhatsApp, you first open the WhatsApp app, and then you don't open anything else, but you can swipe to your right in there until you get to where it says AI chat. It's several swipes to your right when you first open the app itself. You get there, and then you double tap on that, and you have some options when you get in there as to what you want to do with that AI chat feature.
Okay, very good.
Hopefully that is helpful.
All right. Hopefully, Raul, you caught that.
Thank you. Yes.
Very good, Terry Ann, and I am impressed. You can roll your R's. I've been trying to do that, and it doesn't come out near as well as yours. I was even down in Mexico a couple of weeks ago for a week and thought it would help me down if I was down there, and it still didn't help.
My favorite word is ferrocarril, which means railroad. And it has two double R's in it. Ferrocarril. So if you want to practice.
Yeah. Very good. The other thing I can't do is, you know, when they're playing music and some of the guys will do this yell kind of, I can't do that either. I practice that one. I bet you Raul can do that. Where's Raul? Can you do the yell, Raul, for there's good mix of music on?
This is Herbie.
All right, Herbie's going to try it. Go ahead.
No, I just thought I'd mention that he is now the second Raul to be part of iBUG, because we had another Raul early on.
Right, oh, yeah, that's true. All right, Raul.
This is Shree.
I'll let you off the hook today.
And Arriba! Yeah, okay.
All right, good try. All right, Shree, are you going to try it?
No, I can't. I have no talent for that. Even I wanted to ask Sandhya about the, I'm still curious about this diamond stuff here. On the watch, is the band also diamond, or is it just the case of it?
It wasn't that detailed. They said studded. And the other thing that they mentioned was this is going to be a very niche audience, a billionaire club kind of mentality, because, you know, by next year, it's going to be obsolete, you know, depending on if you want to keep on updating your phone. So maybe a $250,000 isn't a big deal for some people. So,
you don't ask for much for your birthday, do you?
Okay, very good. We are about out of time for today, but we certainly so glad that all of you came in and joined us that did, especially Ms. Is Carla Savage from the UK still here?
Don't even try.
Okay, I don't know if she's still here or not, but anyway, I bet you Terry Ann uses WhatsApp to chat with Carla.
I am still here.
I bet you would be right. Yes. Frequently.
All right. Very good.
This is Vincent. Can I ask a quick question?
Yeah, Vincent, go ahead.
Was WhatsApp bought by Google?
Facebook.
Facebook. It was, yeah.
Meta. Facebook. Yeah, Meta.
This is Shree.
Go ahead, Shree.
So just out of curiosity question, if Carla and Terri Ann both have an iPhone, would they have a better experience using WhatsApp or like FaceTime?
I really think in most cases it's about the same.
Yeah.
FaceTime. Would you agree with that, Carla?
I would. I mean, I have talked to my husband through WhatsApp with Android because he's an Android user. And it is still very, very clear. So, yeah, I mean, it's a much of a muchness, to be perfectly honest with you. You can't really tell the difference.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
All right, one of those mixed marriages. Very good. Okay, everybody, thank you again. We are going to sign off now.